Good morning. This is the class of 2011, the ladies of the VA, Ms. Cromwell and Ms. Stewart, Ms. Deskowska and Ms. Claire. And we're here today to interview retired Colonel John Sherner, CRNA, MSN. Little background information on Mr. Sherner here. He graduated nursing school in 1968. His active duty starting February of 1968. Served in Vietnam from 1968 to 1969 as an ER nurse, and came back and entered anesthesia school in 1970 and graduated in 1972 from the Walter Reed Army Medical Center School of Nurse Anesthesia. There he had assignments throughout the Army and retired, well, towards the end of his career, I should say. He was chief CRNA at the Brooke Army Medical Center, and was also the anesthesia nursing consultant to the Army Surgeon General. And retired as a full-bird colonel in 1997, and then 1997 to 2001, he worked at the University of Texas Health Sciences Center here in San Antonio. In 2001, he became the chief CRNA at the Audie L. Murphy VA Hospital. And in 2008, he became the liaison instructor for our program here and will be retiring this year. So we felt it was very important to get some information from Mr. Sherner and gather what information and insight we can from his experience.
Thank you, Ms. Stewart. Mr. Sherner, can you give us your perspective on the evolution of anesthesia from the time you have entered anesthesia until now?
Yeah, I'd be glad to. I think, had these questions a day in advance, so I had a chance to think about them a little bit. And I think probably the biggest perspective that has happened since I entered anesthesia school in 1970 is that when I entered the program, the U.S. Army program, it was more of an art rather than a science. And as the years have gone by, the practice of anesthesia is probably more of a science than an art. Although there's still a little bit of art involved in the practice of anesthesia, it's become more technologically and more science-based, evidence-based than it ever was when I started anesthesia school. So I think that's probably the biggest difference that I've seen is that it's become more and more science-based, as evidenced by the change in our educational environment. When I went to anesthesia school, we had 6 months of didactic and a year of clinical. And starting in June of this year, they're going to be a year of didactic and 2 years of clinical, resulting in a doctorate of nursing practice. So I think that's probably the biggest change that I've seen. It has become more science oriented and less art involved in it, although there'll always be a little bit of art involved in the practice of anesthesia, but it's a necessitated a move to a doctoral prepared clinical aspect of the nursing anesthesia practice.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so how has your professional interaction with anesthesiologists changed over time during your practice?
I think one of the things that have changed when I first came into anesthesia, there was a lot more on the surface issues with anesthesiologists and nurse anesthetists. It was something that was more evident than in today's environment, although I think our organizations still deal with it on a daily basis as far as the differences in practice between a nurse anesthetist and an anesthesiologist based on whether it's a practice of nursing or it's a practice of medicine. It was more, I think, evident back then than it is today. I think it's more below the surface issues that are being dealt at our organizational level and at the political level than it ever was when I was involved. We now have, both organizations have political active PACs or campaigns that actually, committees that actually deal with the issues of nurse anesthetists and anesthesiologists and represent themselves before Congress to try to get favorable legislation for each organization. That was never the practice when I was starting out in anesthesia. It was, we just had some differences in how we practiced anesthesia, which manifested itself in some difficult clinical situations, clinical work environment back then. Now it's not quite as evident in today's practice. Again, it's more below the surface.
So how would you compare and contrast that interaction between the different institution types that you've been able to experience in your career?
I think the biggest thing is that we as nurse anesthetists and anesthesiologists have gotten to the point now where I think we respect both our educational processes and our clinical experience. And because we respect how they were trained, how anesthesiologists were trained in their experiences, and they respect how we are trained in our experiences, that makes it much, much more easy for us to get along on a daily basis. I think certainly the courts, when there have been some issues involved that involve legislative issues or court issues, a lot of the issues have been in favor of nurse anesthetist practice. So I think those things have gone a long way to document that indeed anesthesia practiced by nurse anesthetists is indeed safe. It is within our scope of practice, that outcomes are same, whether it's a nurse anesthetist or an anesthesiologist involved in the practice. So I think those things have made it a lot easier for us to work together in a team effort, not so much the definition of a team effort by the anesthesiologist organization, but just getting along and practicing on a daily basis for the good of the patient. I personally have worked with by myself in many, many assignments in the military and the civilian community without anesthesiologist supervision. I've worked with anesthesiologists in places, and things have worked out very, very well. I'd like to have the opinion and the experience of whether it's another nurse anesthetist or an anesthesiologist when I practice anesthesia, when I have issues that I'm familiar with. Anesthesiologists, I think, can be used as a viable resource for us to practice anesthesia. Again, with the ultimate goal that the patient benefits from both our sets of hands and our cognitive experiences that we have overall. So, yes, I can work by myself, but I think it's good to work with anesthesiologists and other nurse anesthetists to use them as resource people.
Thank you.
Okay. So one of my questions to you is, how do you handle the challenge of staying competent with the latest evidence-based practice and all the new technology, because it's a continually evolving practice?
I think that's a good question. I think one of the things that when you graduate from your program, one of the hardest things as new graduates and students do is to try to keep clinically current. It's very, very difficult to do, and the longer you're away from the academic institution, the harder it is to maintain clinically current, especially if you're out someplace in a small rural practice area where you may be the only one or two anesthesia providers. It's very, very difficult to keep clinically current. Does that mean you're not a safe practitioner? No, I think you can still do a good anesthetic, but I think you need to broaden your horizons by some mechanism in order to make sure that you're currently up with the new anesthetic agents, IV inhalation anesthetic agents techniques, whether it be ultrasound or whatever techniques are out there that are new. It's very difficult to do, so you have to kind of force yourself to read those journals to make sure that you do read different articles. I think it's much, much easier nowadays with the internet access, that you can get access to a lot of information that was not available when I was right out of anesthesia school. I think one of the things you have to do is you can't be complacent. You have to constantly challenge yourself. You can't be afraid to try new things and new experiences. That's where I think working with other people, other anesthesiologists, other nurse anesthetists can provide you that input of how they do things, maybe different than yours. Learn from the new graduates come out of the program. the graduates who come out of this program 2 years from now are probably going to have a little bit more experiences, different experiences, because of introduction of new techniques. So I think that's going to be something that you can be able to do. I think obviously the best place to be to practice from trying to gain new knowledge is in an academic setting. So if you work in an institution that has an affiliation with a university where their residents or nursing anesthesia programs, it's going to challenge you to make sure that you're currently competent or up to date in your anesthesia practice. Again, it's much, much harder for those people that are out in rural areas, small areas, where there's not a lot of things to stimulate your environment because the practice is the same day in and day out. But you can't be afraid to try new things. You have to challenge yourself on a daily basis.
Thank you.
What would you say is the most significant anesthesia advancement that has impacted your own personal practice?
Well, I thought about that question long and hard last night and this morning, is that because there are so many different things that have come into the practice of anesthesia since I started anesthesia school. Is it the inhalation anesthetic agents that we have nowadays, which are so much different than the anesthetic agents that I use, like ether and penthrane and fluoramar, cyclopropane? There are so much better agents from that standpoint. Is it the advent of the pulse oximeter or the end-tidal CO2 monitor, which were non-existent when I went through anesthesia school? So I can't put my finger on one particular technological advance or one particular anesthetic drug or agent. It's just in a combination of things over a 40-year period of time that have evolved the anesthesia practice where it's very, very safe today. I think the mortality or morbidity associated with anesthesia now is like 1 in 300,000. When I went to anesthesia school, it was 1 in 2,000. So things have changed so much since then. And I often wonder what it's going to be like when you have 40 years of anesthesia practice and you're under your belt and you look back at what you're being taught now and what's actually going to be done 40 years from now. The changes are probably going to be just as evolutionary. There are going to be so many different things that are coming on board, and you can't put your finger on it specifically just one. But they're a culmination of a lot of different things. I think the advent of the pulse oximeter and tidal CO2 gone a long way to make it much, much more safer for our patients that we provide in anesthesia school. And the inhalation anesthetic agents and the IV anesthetic drugs are really help us to provide a safe anesthetic to those individuals. So I think overall, many, many different things. The anesthesia machines are much different now. The monitoring devices are much different. I think it's just going to get better.
Mr. Sherner, you've had so many different experiences and so many different settings to practice anesthesia. We were just wondering if you could elaborate on some of the cultural and practice disparities that you've encountered in some of the various settings, whatever, you know.
I think I often, when people ask me questions similar to that, I think our anesthesia practice in the United States is, from a nurse anesthesia standpoint, can be very schizophrenic, especially in the military, because in the military we can go to one small place where there are minimal anesthesiologists or no anesthesiologists, and we're practicing in an autonomous setting, and then we go to a medical center where our practice may be a little bit more scrutinized. And the same thing in the civilian community. I think 20% of our nurse anesthetists now practice in a rural setting, practice by themselves, independent practitioners. I'll go back. 20% of our nurse anesthetists practice independently, and about 60% of our anesthetics that are performed in the United States in rural areas are performed by nurse anesthetists, not anesthesiologists. So we're in the rural areas. 20% of us are practicing without anesthesiology input, and then we can go someplace else, and then we kind of have to change our practice patterns a little bit because the institution that we work in mandates close supervision or medically directed practice. And so I think that's hard for us, especially if we've been from in a place where we are autonomous, and then we go to a practice setting that's more constrictive and regulatory, makes it much, much more difficult for us overall. I think the other cultural change, and you may not relate to it as VA individuals, but in the Army, nurse anesthetists fall on the Department of Nursing. And so we have a lot of input. We are involved in the hospital and the nursing realm, where in most other facilities, we don't fall in the civilian community, we don't fall under the Department of Nursing. We fall under the Department of Surgery or their own department, anesthesia department. And I think that's significant because, first of all, we may have a tendency to lose our identity with our nursing colleagues. And a lot of times we have to have a champion for our cause, and sometimes nursing in general can be a champion for our cause as nurse anesthetists, because we are, our basic education is at the nursing level. And so I think that's one of the things that is a little bit different from a cultural standpoint or organizational standpoint, that we lose that connectivity with the nursing side of the house, which some people might think it's good, and other people may think it may not be quite as good. I think we need to keep that connection, because I think it does benefit us from a lot of different perspectives. There are definitely a lot more nurses than there are nurse anesthetists. They have a powerful organization that can help us in different things. I think we can use the Department of Nursing to further our nurse anesthesia profession by identifying individuals who are interested in becoming nurse anesthetists and kind of mentor them and foster them along the way. So I think that's one thing that really is a little bit different from my perspective, that I wish we had more of in the VA system anyways, more of a link with our nursing brethren, so to speak.
Thank you.
So would you mind walking us through one of your first experiences from cart setup, monitoring the patient, just how a typical, for example, open drop ether anesthetic would look like?
Sure, I can tell you two things right now. I can tell you what my first anesthetic was, and I can tell you 2 months from now what my last anesthetic was. My first anesthetic was an individual that was having a D&C for vaginal bleeding in a lithotomy position. We used pentothal, Demerol, ethylene oxide, and oxygen as our anesthetic plan. Ethylene oxide is similar to nitrous oxide in its characteristics. It has a little garlicky type of smell, and it comes in a red cylinder, which we don't see anymore. But 1971 was the last time probably that ethylene oxide was used in the United States. In my program, we had to do so many open drop ethers and so many ethers through a what we call a number 8 vaporizer, kind of a draw over vaporizer. This is an example of a Yankauer mask. And essentially what it is it looks like a strainer. And it has a couple of different devices on it. This face like a mask, so it goes over the patient's nose and mouth like this. You can see here there's a little port. This is for insufflation of oxygen, okay? It's hooked up to a little tubing that delivers oxygen. And what happens is that with this Yankauer mask, you put a certain layer or thickness of 4x4 gauze, either 8 to 10 layers of 4x4 gauze, and you put the gauze on and you hold it in place with this device here. And then what happens is I'm going to go over and move towards this patient. And let me go ahead and just show you what we can do with this 4x4 gauze. Essentially, we just put it like this. And depending on how many layers you had, kind of helps speed up the induction or slow down the induction. And what happens, we put this, essentially what we do is we don't put it directly on the patient's mouth at this point in time. The patient is usually sedated. And one of the things that changed a lot that has affected anesthesia practices, most of our patients, when I started anesthesia school, came in 1 or 2 days before their anesthetic experience. So we saw them the night before. We gave them the pre-medication in the morning, whether it's Demerol or morphine, scopolamine or atropine, whatever it may be. So they came down to the operating room fairly sedated. And then the patient would come into the room, we put our monitoring devices on, which usually consisted of two devices, a blood pressure cuff and a precordial stethoscope. And then our ether came in a, if you can think of a condensed milk can, that's about the same size as the ether can that came in. And we had a little hole with a church key that you used to open bottles of beer, cans of beer. And then we put a little pipe strainer, a pipe, which actually would act as a drip chamber for the ether. And so we would start saturating. We'd saturate the ether, the gauze with the ether before we put the patient's on the patient's face, and we hold it like this. And then as the patient, it vaporizes very, very quickly. And as the patient breathes, we lower the Yankar mask and continue dropping the ether on the patient until the patient loses consciousness. And at that point in time, we can control the patient airway, and we continue in dropping ether until the patient becomes unconscious. And then we use the signs and stages of anesthesia developed by Goodell. We look at the eye signs, the respirations, the muscle relaxation, and that determines the depth of anesthesia. When the patient's eye signs are in a certain characteristics, we know that the patient is in a certain stage and plane of anesthesia, and then we tell the surgeons to go ahead and make their incision. Depending on the response, we would increase our rate drip of our ether anesthesia or decrease the drip, the rate of our anesthesia. But we always continually had to saturate the gauze, the Yankar mask, because if we stopped, ether was very, very vaporized very, very quickly, and this would dry out very, very quickly, and what would happen, the patient would wake up. So you had to constantly drip the ether. And then, as the case went on, ether is very, very lipophilic. It's really absorbed by the fatty tissue. Once we got to that area, and it's been a period of time, 1 or 2 hours, for ether, then we can decrease the amount of ether that's going to be dropped on the actual Yankauer mask. And then all the ether that's been absorbed by the fatty tissue eventually will come out of the tissue, and it still has its anesthetic effect, so we can kind of coast on what's in the tissues for a period of time while we're waking the patient up. And so it takes anywhere from 10 or 15 minutes for all the ether that's been absorbed by the fatty tissue to come out of the body and be exhaled by the patient. And that's when the patient would start to wake up. It's not in today's anesthesia practice. Most of our patients that leave the operating room are fairly quickly awake and responding to verbal stimuli. That is not, was not always true in our patients with ether anesthesia, because it did take a long time for the ether to be expelled or exhaled by the pulmonary system. So a lot of times our patients would be placed in a lateral position to help prevent any aspiration from occurring until they went to the post-anesthesia care unit, and they stayed there sometimes 1 or 2 hours before they actually were able to wake and respond to verbal stimuli to maintain the reflexes. So a lot of things have changed since then, but the patients a lot of times went to the recovery room in the lateral position, and they're still waking up from the ether anesthesia. So again, this is one of the things that we did as part of our requirements, and I think we did 35 or 40 open drop ether, and then we did about 100 cases with ether through a vaporizing system that was incorporated in our anesthesia machine. The downside to this is that not only did the patient inhale the ether, but we also inhaled the ether, and it was can be very, very, make you very, very somnolent as a result of that, because it is a very enclosed space. The ether vapor not only comes to you, to the patient, but to you also. So again, we've made tremendous strides in our practice of anesthesia, but it still has some applicability in today's anesthesia practice.
So how would you handle the somnolence, like if you were doing a case? Do you step back?
Just what happens, some people come and give you a break. You would go home and you'd smell ether on your clothes and your hair. It just takes a long time to get rid of out of your system. But it can make you very, very sleepy. You're just going to have to step back a little bit, and somebody will maybe ask you to somebody come out. Can you give me a break at this point in time? Because I'm feeling a little bit sleepy from the ether. Again, a lot of times we'd use open drop to put the patient to sleep. And then after they're asleep, we would intubate them. And then we would hook up our ether through a vaporizer system, like I told you about. And that kind of enclosed it a little bit. Didn't get quite as much ether vapor, but it still was a system that we didn't have scavenging systems like we do now. So the ether anesthetic that was exhaled from the patient just went out into the environment. So it can be very, very, you know, the other thing that we always concern about is that when we did ether, it was very, very flammable. We didn't have a lot of cautery back then, but we had things, anything that caused a spark could cause ether to explode. So a lot of times we had wet towels on the floor to make sure that it decreased the incidence of having any sparks that might cause combustion with the ether vapor itself. So it was always a little bit scary to do ether anesthesia because you always were worried about fire in the operating room. And cyclopropane was the same way, another very, 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 very good anesthetic agent that was fast on, fast off, but it was highly combustible, highly flammable from that standpoint.
So what year was your last ether?
Last year, it was probably in